92.3 FM, WMXD. The salute to the Temptations. A special tribute to Mr. David Ruffin, who tragically passed away earlier today. Like thousands of other Detroiters who were shocked and saddened, many made their way to the Motown Museum, where it all started for Mr. David Ruffin. When I went there today, TV camera crews were there. People were just stopping by the Motown Museum right off of Grand Boulevard, as if it were a shrine, which it is very much a shrine, to all of the Motown stars and to all of the things that Motown meant to the world. These artifacts are embodied there at the Motown Museum. The founder of the Motown Museum, Mrs. Esther Edwards, was there. She was nice enough to talk to me, spent a few hours talking to me about the Temptations, about David Ruffin when he first joined the Motown stable and how he got there. And I asked her if she could talk with me later on tonight, and she graciously accepted, and we have her on the line right now. Hello, Mrs. Edwards.
Hello, Mojo.
All right, how are you today?
Well, I'm just fine, considering the sadness that we have for, you know, hearing about the death of David Ruffin. But everything is fine otherwise.
David Ruffin came up to Detroit from Meridian, Mississippi. Is that correct?
Yes, that's right.
How did he get to Motown?
Well, actually, you know, when I was talking with my sister Gwendolyn Gordy Fuqua, and you know, Gwendolyn owned Anna Records, and it seems that a friend of David's brought him to Detroit and brought him over to Anna Records, and because there was a flat over her company on St. Antoine and Farnsworth, David stayed there, and Gwen signed David to a recording contract, and he had a couple of records on Anna, and then subsequently she steered David over to Motown, to Barry's company, Motown Records.
What kind of guy was David Ruffin?
Well, David, in those days, I knew David. He was quiet spoken and, you know, just a nice person and very talented always. And when he joined the Temptations, he fit the group perfectly. You know, the guys were handsome and very much together, and just a kind of a unified group, and David fitted in just fine. And the first hit recording that the Temptations had, David Ruffin was a part of that group, at, you know, and I think it was about 1963 when David joined the Temps. And their first first hit was "The Way You Do the Things You Do." Of course, Eddie Kendricks was leading it, but it was David and Melvin and Otis and Eddie.
We were talking earlier about how they got along as a group. You had mentioned that
And Paul Williams, I'm sorry, I left Paul out.
Mm-hmm. You were mentioning how they got along as a group, how they always tried to look out for each other, and they very much acted like an organization.
Yes, that's correct. Yes, they monitored each other's activities, and they had their own ground rules and their codes, you know, of ethics, and they just, you know, they'd find each other for being late or different things. They really was a together group, and they wanted to look good and they wanted to be the best. And they worked hard and they practiced hard. And they were not overnight successes. It took about 4 years. David was not one of the original members, but he joined the group in 63. And, of course, they had not had any hits up until that time. And after the way you do the things you do, the Temps never looked back, and they were just a group that was an idol to many, many young men across this country and even in foreign countries. They had their style and they had their synchronization, and they were just great to look at. David was a real lead singer. In fact, so many of the Temps could sing the lead, and they were unique. They were different, and they were just an exciting, wonderful group, and they still are today, really.
Mm-hmm. We're speaking with Mrs. Esther Edwards, the sister of Barry Gordy, and the founder of the Motown Museum. What would you say, what did David Ruffin bring to the group that wasn't already there? Or maybe it was there, and maybe his presence brought it out even more.
Well, I think David, on stage, David brought probably some additional excitement and a different kind of excitement, you know. The Temps had, you know, great voices and great harmony, and they were good dancers. Paul Williams, I think, was like their choreographer, so to speak. And they would come up with these steps, and of course, in the Motown Artist Personal Development Department, Charlie Atkins helped them to synchronize those steps. But they could really dance. They could do the Temptation Walk. But David added, I think, some more excitement to the dance and did some little extra things. Off stage, I knew David is kind of quiet spoken and not having a great deal to say. In those early days, he was a member of the Temptations from 1963 to about 1968, when he still stayed at Motown, but became a solo act. Until about 79, I believe it was.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when he went to Atlantic Records. But he rejoined the Temps in 1982 for this reunion LP, which is a classic LP.
It certainly is.
Mm-hmm.
As the founder of the Motown Museum, at a moment like this, with the loss of such an incredibly talented entertainer such as David Ruffin, I would be remiss not to say that the world is indebted to you, because you have single-handedly taken on the project of putting a museum together, enshrining all of the artifacts and the things that made Motown Records happen. And I was in there and I saw the original uniform that this group wore on stage. I guess they must have worn it during one of the Motown reviews.
Oh, yes. Yes.
When you first started putting this together, how did that come about, putting a museum together?
Well, I want to say that I haven't quite done it single-handedly, because there's some wonderful volunteers that help out in the museum. I couldn't do it otherwise. And we have a few very dedicated staff members. But the idea, the museum just kind of started evolving around me when the Motown headquarters moved out to California, and we moved from the building downtown on Woodward Avenue. Then the Hitsville USA house that had the recording studio had been operable, and the recording sessions were still going on 24 hours a day from 1959 to 1972. That house, Hitsville USA at 2648 West Grand Boulevard there, a little west of Henry Ford Hospital, became the Detroit branch office in 1972 when the headquarters moved to Hollywood, California. And I became I was senior vice president of the company, and so I stayed there and to oversee the Detroit operation. And people would just show up on the doorstep. They would come from mostly from the foreign countries. And one day I looked out, and it was like the whole British Navy was out there, all these young men in white and with this accent, and they had just docked in Toledo and took a bus to come over to see where it all began. Where did Dinah Ross, Stevie Wonder, Smokey Robinson, Marvin Guy, they called him, where they started, and they were just amazed, and it was just, and they treated it like it was a shrine, as did so many other visitors, mostly foreign visitors. And it was at that point I began to realize that, hey, maybe Motown made history. Maybe Detroit was had, you know, something else to be very proud of. And so, as I said, it just started evolving, and that gave me the idea, well, maybe we should display some of the artifacts and some of the gold records and some of the awards and some of the photos, so that if these people are going to hop the Atlantic Ocean or the Pacific Ocean to come to Detroit just to see us, as many of them said, then maybe we should have something for them to look at. And so that's how the museum started evolving. And because we were not a corporate project, we formed a Motown Museum Foundation, which is a 501c3 nonprofit, to try to make this museum happen so that we could preserve the history, this era in American music history that had such a global impact. And it started right here in Detroit by just a young black man who really didn't set out to build a Motown, but Berry Gordy just did not wish to work on the production line in the factory as a career, and he didn't like the routine job, and so he just quit that job, and it was a good $85 a week job in those days, and he just quit it to said he was going to be a songwriter, and had no intentions he had almost given up his dream of, being making $1 million. That's mm-hmm. what he always, when mm-hmm. he was young, he always said he wanted right. to be a boxer, because he'd hear about these $1 million gates and things like that, you see. So he just thought he'd be a songwriter, and he didn't know that that was a great deal of money or anything like that. And one thing led to another, and that's the way Motown got started. And it seems that the museum is kind of parallel to that. It just started evolving, and now the ball has begun to roll, and we have great plans, because we really would like to preserve this history, because we wanted to inspire and motivate and educate especially young people, to know that, you know, you what can happen if you just pursue your dream. And with a unity and togetherness and love and support for each other and keeping the plan.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, you know, that's
the way it got started.
What's happening at the museum, and we certainly appreciate every bit of help that we can get. And as I said, I can't do it single-handedly, and I haven't, but with the help of the people of Detroit, I'm sure that we can build a world-class museum that we will all be proud of.
Well, what are the hours of operation?
Monday through Friday, from 10 until 5, Monday through Friday, and on Sundays from 2 to 5. And, of course, we're closed on holidays.
Right.
And there's a $3 admission, $2 for children under 12. And we have a souvenir shop, and that is what supports the museum at this point.
It would be great to see, all of the dreams and hopes that you have for the museum come to pass, because I think that events like this, though tragic, very tragic.
Yeah, it's very sad, and we're very sorry, because David was a young man and so talented, you know, such a one of a kind entertainer with his own style, and just so unfortunate, that. The problems of today, the drugs and so forth. It's just too bad. It's just really saddening that young people have to be exposed to that kind of possibility.
Well, the. With the museum, at least all of the David Ruffin fans tomorrow, Temptations fans, they can walk in the footsteps of giants because of your efforts to preserve, this great facility. Earlier today, I saw the uniforms that the Temptations wore on stage, the very shoes that they danced in, and I think it's pretty incredible to have a facility that these great memories of the past have been enshrined in. And I think that, the world owes you a standing ovation for making sure that these things were preserved and are still being preserved.
Well, thank you, Mojo. Thank you very much.
And I'll see you tomorrow at the museum.
All right. I'll certainly look forward to you, seeing you tomorrow. Thanks a million.
And thank you very much for your time.
All right.
This is WMXD. We've been speaking with Mrs. Esther Edwards, the sister of Barry Gordy, the founder of the Motown Museum, sharing some memories on Mr. David Ruffin. You're listening to the tribute to Mr. David Ruffin and the Temptations. In just a few minutes, we'll be talking with Miss Gwen Gordy Fuqua. When David Ruffin came from Meridian, Mississippi, the first label he signed with was Anna Records. And we'll be talking with Ms. Fuqua in just a few seconds on 92.3 FM and the continuing tribute to Mr. David Ruffin. 92.3 FM, Electrifying Mojo. And our continuing tribute to Mr. David Ruffin on the line right now is Ms. Gwen Gordy Fuqua, who owned Anna Records. And at that time, was introduced to Mr. David Ruffin. Hello, Ms. Fuqua.
Hello.
How are you tonight?
Oh, a little sad and a little shocked. How are you?
I'm doing fine. And about the same situation, I guess the whole city of Detroit right now, and perhaps the world, is in shock because David Ruffin was definitely a very respected entertainer, course, you saw all of that a long time ago, long before the world saw it, and you were very instrumental in bringing the talents of David Ruffin to the world. When he was first introduced to you and brought up from Meridian, Mississippi, let's talk about that.
I love David very much. A friend of his named Eddie, I don't remember his last name at this particular time, but he brought David to me. At the time, I had Anna Records. And he said that, hey, I brought this boy from Mississippi. He says, but I don't have any place to keep him, and I don't know exactly what to do with him. He says, but I brought him to you. He said, because I heard a lot of nice things about you. He says, I met you a time or two. He says, you probably don't remember me. He says, but, you know, I want you to hear him. So he says, but the only thing about it, he says, I don't have a place for him to live. So I said, well, okay, we'll hear him. So, of course, I heard David, and I thought he was really a superstar. And he really was, I mean, he's so energetic. He was young, and he really wanted to be in the entertainment business. And he was seemed like a very nice person. So, of course, over Anna Records, my dad owned a building there on Farnsworth and St. Antoine. We had two family flats. So then David, as a lot of the other artists, stayed there. And, of course, I signed him to management. And then we just rehearsed. We did a lot of rehearsing. But every rehearsal that he had was just like a performance on the stage. And I thought he was going to be a super talent, which he turned out to be.
Okay, and from Anna Records, he went to Motown Records.
Yes, he went to my brother Barry, as most of the artists from Anna Records, because Barry and them were on the big move, and came from Anna Records and went to Barry.
When David was first introduced to you, and you were basically taking a look at other talent that was also being introduced to you at the time, what was it about him just said, okay, well, this one I think we should sign? And how does it feel when you make those type decisions and you have it turn out to be so overwhelmingly right? When David was first introduced to you, as was a lot of other entertainers, what was it about him that said, yep, that one is going to be one of the big ones?
Well, because he was really into it. He wanted to be a superstar. He wanted to be the best. You know, a lot of times, you know, people that have a great or a good voice, they just perform and they do. But he always was one of the ones that overdid. You know, in rehearsals, he was just like he wanted to. He wanted to be the, you know, he wanted to be the. He would rehearse everything that you saw him do on stage almost. Was the way he rehearsed. And of course we had we did a little grooming and we did a lot of things with him, but he had it in him. He wanted to be there, and he worked very hard, and there was never a time that he could rehearse for 8 hours if that's what it's called for.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he was just there, and he just was there for you, and he wanted to be there, and he wanted to be in front of the public. He loved people. He was just a great personality and a great fellow.
We're speaking live with Miss Fuqua, Gwen Fuqua, in California, and she's in California right now, and she was nice enough to talk to us on the phone, and that we're doing the David Ruffin tribute. One last question. The steps that David and the Temptations were doing, how did those steps come about? Did he bring that energy to the group?
Well, he was energetic. His steps were not especially those steps. Barry had a thing. When he was with the Temptations, Barry had a department, which I headed up, with Harvey Fuqua, Charlie Atkins, and Maxine Powell. I headed up the department. And, of course, they got their choreography from Charlie Atkins. They got a lot of the things from Harvey. And it was just all about everybody that was in that department.
Well, thank you very much, Mrs. Fuqua, for spending this time talking to us live in California on this David Ruffin tribute. And we wish you continued success. And once again, thank you for sharing the microphone with us.
All right. Thank you, Mojo. And it was nice talking with you on 92.3 FM, right?
92.3 FM. You got it. All the way in California.
I hear about you out here.
You
so
did.
God bless you. And we'll think about David and we'll just pray on that.
Well, thank you very much. WMXD Detroit. I'd like to thank Mrs. Gwen Fuqua, Mrs. Esther Edwards, for sharing with us some historical moments on Mr. David Ruffin.
Deep down inside, you know it ain't true. you don't care, cause you already made up your mind, you're gonna run away. You're on your way. Fast, you're on your own at last. Hey, it's getting late, where will you sleep?
You're getting kind of hungry, but you forgot to bring something to eat.
Oh, lost but no money, you start to cry. But remember, you left home wanting to be grown. So dry your weeping eyes. About little boys running away from home and their parents don't see them no more.
You wanna stop the hitch a ride, I know.
But your mama told you never trust a stranger and you don't know which way to go. Streets are dark and deserted, not a sound, not a sign of life. Oh, how you long to hear your mother's voice, cause you're lost and alone. Remember, you made the choice. Oh, run away, child, running wild. Better go back home where you belong. Hey, run away, child, running wild. Better go back home where you belong. You're lost in this great big city.
Get down, huh? Boom, boom, a boom, boom, boom. I'm the bass, get down, huh? Boom, 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 a boom, boom, boom. I'm the bass, get down, huh? Just dance and hum along. Now listen.
Electrifying Mojo, and right now we are live at Swanson's Funeral Home, where Mr. David Ruffin is lying in state. I have to tell you that the turnout here at the funeral home today has been overwhelming. There are blocks of people lined up right now to come inside to take a last look at Mr. Ruffin. We're here now with a young lady who talked with David Ruffin about 2 weeks ago. Pam Todd, how are you, Pam?
Hi, how are you, Mojo? Long time.
Long time. Okay. And I know this is a sad occasion to meet you on again. But let's talk a little bit about David Ruffin and what he meant to music, what he meant to the city, and what he meant to the world.
Yes, I've been knowing David for about 26 years. David and I were friends from a long time. And as a matter of fact, remember, Mojo, I used to be one of David's background singers. And also I was managed by Eddie Kendrick. So David and Eddie, I owe them a lot as far as my career. David was a good guy. We all have problems, but in this business, you must be strong. And David just got caught up.
The lines of people, this is Lynn Swanson of the Swanson Funeral Home. Lynn, thousands of people have passed through here today, and since yesterday, one police officer said a rough estimate of maybe about 20,000 people. People have just not stopped coming, have they?
Absolutely not. Since about 11:30 this morning, Mojo, I guess when we arrived here, there were people camped out on our property all the way around, lined up and down the streets, even in the neighborhood, waiting and reminiscing about his music and Motown, the Motown family. And I guess since opening this afternoon, there have been over 12 or 15,000 people in here. That's just today.
There's virtually a traffic jam. This is 6 Mile and what? What is the cross street here?
We are one block west of Hubble.
There's virtually a traffic jam out there.
It took me about 5 minutes to get through this one block area. Cars, people, and people are still coming. How long will this be going on tonight?
We'll be doing until 9 o'clock tonight, but I think you'll agree with me, Mojo, that we really have to give it to the Detroit Police Department and in particular the reservists, who have been so cooperative. They have really kept things organized since yesterday, and they've done just a phenomenal job. And the people have been very cooperative. We haven't had a problem at all.
One interesting thing that just to show you how deep this actually goes, people walking past Mr. Ruffin, and it's leaving literally in tears, and
right.
You've had to call doctors. People are fainting around here.
Absolutely.
And will there be viewing tomorrow as well?
We're encouraging the public to certainly come this evening, as tomorrow it may be very, very difficult for them to be able to do.
Lynn Swanson of the Swanson Funeral Home, I do appreciate you talking to us. Right now we're going to go directly to music from the Temptations in memory of Mr. David Ruffin, in memory of Mr. Paul Williams, and a salute to one of the greatest groups ever in the history of the world, the mighty, mighty Temptations on 92.3 The Mix.
MXD Detroit.
92.3 FM Electrifying Mojo. We're still live here at Swanson's Funeral Home on 6 Mile. What is the cross street here again? Well, one block west of Hubble. The viewing was to have stopped at 9 p.m., but due to the overwhelming crowd response, people still in line, the people that are in line right now are allowed to pass by Mr. Ruffin. It doesn't appear to be any let up in the crowd whatsoever. This will be the last opportunity to see Mr. Ruffin. We're here right now with Lynn Swanson of Swanson's Funeral Home. And Lynn, the Swanson Funeral Home has, you know, been set in national standards, and the people who are coming out are pleased to take a look at Mr. Ruffin during this last hour and remember the greatness of the Temptations, and you've captured the splendor of the tall Temptations right here on this final moment. People, you were to the door at 9 o'clock, but you can't. Why can't you?
We absolutely can't do that, Mojo. You know, on behalf of his children, Cheryl, Nedra, David Jr., and Kim, we just want to at this time express gratitude to the metropolitan area and to those people that have traveled from across the country. There have been people that convoyed here from California, from Washington, from Mississippi, all over the country, by car, by bus, by mobile home, to be here, and there are just lines of people outside of the funeral home now, and we can't turn them away because they've come to pay their final respects to the family and, of course, to see him and to reminisce. So we'll be here.
And David Ruffin Jr. Is here and is taking it especially hard, and his children are here at the funeral home right now. Tomorrow, will it be a closed funeral tomorrow, or this is their last chance to see? There would be no viewing tomorrow at all, right?
There won't be any viewing here at the funeral home. The service starts at 1 o'clock at the New Bethel Baptist Church, but we are encouraging everyone that wants to see him to come today, as when we go into the church, the casket will be closed, of course, and since seating is very limited, we're encouraging the public to come this evening.
The funeral, could you give me the church and the address of the services tomorrow?
The New Bethel Baptist Church is located on Linwood, that's C.L. Franklin Boulevard and LaSalle, right there at the corner. Services are at 1 o'clock promptly tomorrow.
Lynn Swanson of Swanson Funeral Home. This is Electrifying Mojo, and we're closing things out right here. at the Swanson Chapel. The people that are in line will get a chance to come in. However, are you going to tag the last person in line? Of course, you're going to have to go around the block to do that.
No, we can't, Mojo. You know, I guess I was at Comerica Bank a few weeks ago, and they did that. I was the last car in line, and that's a good practice. But this isn't business. This is about love. This is about memory, and we don't plan to do that, no.
You have the music of the Temptations blast, and there are flowers everywhere, and people are here coming to pay their last respects to Mr. Ruffin, singing the Temptation songs as they go out. Carl Carlton came through. A lot of stars in their own right are here, and it's quite an affair that's happening right here tonight. The Detroit Police Department, you had mentioned, have been above and beyond the call of duty and keeping order.
Absolutely. We take our hats off again to the Detroit Reservists and the Detroit Police Department, as they have been super cooperative. And I give it to the citizens of Detroit. You know, you always hear the negative thing about our people when we gather, but everyone has just been wonderful and very cooperative. We've had just a phenomenal crowd yesterday and today, but we haven't had a problem, not one. People have been standing in line, reminiscing about the music, talking and dancing. They're carrying their radios and boomboxes, playing his music, and they're just having a good time, just a good time. And they've transformed this funeral home into old Motown, and it's been very special, very special.
Lynn Swanson of Swanson Funeral Home. This is Electrifying Mojo live on the streets of Detroit, 92.3 The Mix.
You're listening to Electrifying Mojo, Rare Moments. If you like this video, hit the like button. If you wish to subscribe, hit the subscription button. If you like this video, hit the like button. If you wish to subscribe, hit the subscription button. If you wish to subscribe, hit the subscription button. Do not ever leave home without your mask. Do not ever cook food for you or anyone else without your mask. Do not serve food without your mask. Do not talk to anyone without your mask. And that's 6 feet away. The 6 foot distancing from another person is not a substitute for wearing your mask. It's plus wearing your mask. What are the consequences of not staying 6 feet apart? It could be a decision to stay 6 feet apart or being 6 feet under. The safest place for you is at home. If you must leave home, keep a 6 foot distance from whomever you encounter. Wash your hands constantly. Do not touch your face. Wear disposable gloves wherever you go. Dispose of those gloves once you're back in your safe location. Good friends keep good friends 6 feet away so they can live to see another day. That is the new meaning of friendship. I give 6 foot fist pumps for days.